This is Josiah Plays Torment, Tides of Numenera. Alright, we're speaking with Inifir, and now we're going to do the Mirrorcaster thing.
I'll remember that.
So I've already been through this part of the conversation, so I'm not going to read it out loud again. Said this before. So now I do this persuasion check again. I'm going to go up to 95%. Alright, he says, have it all. And then, we've read this before. Okay, boom. Now we go into the mirror, finally. In every direction, all is gray. A dreary sky above the calm sea on which you float. The air is wet and lukewarm like the water below. The only sound is the wind's susurrus, so faint as to raise no waves. Weightless and alone, you're not deprived of sensations, but relieved of them. For a moment, you bask in something like rapture, a purely physical bliss that belongs to this body, not to you. Then, it's gone, replaced with a rush of terror and rage and violation. Go away! Your mind screams at you. Without your will, against your will, your body convulses. You are no longer floating effortlessly. You are thrashing desperately, trying and not trying to drown. Let's try using concentration. Tell your mind stop fighting. Oh, I have 100% on this without even using effort. Sweet. Success. For a moment, you have control of your body and mind. You sink your claws deep, and no thrashing will shake you loose entirely. But thrash your body does, and so does your mind, as a wild shrieking echoes around you. Out! Out! You can't take this from me! You won't! It's Inifir, only seized by a wild terror he never showed in the flesh. Your body, his body, the flesh that now houses you both, twists spastically in the water. Inifir doesn't seem to be trying to drown, but caught up in his struggle against you and panicked by your presence, he doesn't seem to be able to swim or float either. Why is his mind still here? This never happened before. Yeah, so something weird is going on in this mare that's different from the other mares we've been in. You slip underwater and discover you're not alone. Dozens of corpses bob around you, some just a few feet from the surface, some in the darker depths. Among them is Choi Kaisul. It's no longer quiet, but it seemed the whisper of a breeze was, in fact, the droning of the dead. Now, with the water's amplification, you can hear them distinctly.
Filth! Worthless slut! Traitor! Nobody! Monster!
Some jeer. Shame, shame, moans another. Fraud, one cries out, clear as truth. Choi just weeps. Wow, so this is pretty grim. Inifir's consciousness seems overwhelmed by the tumult. Your body stopped flailing and is merely sinking. But his innervation affects you as well, and your limbs feel leaden and lifeless. What do I want to do here? Swim toward the surface, swim toward Choi, swim downwards. Snap out of it. Let's try to swim toward Choi. Every stroke is a struggle. This body is already weaker than the one to which you've become accustomed, and it balks at your commands like a spent anine. Inifir is not working against you, but his will sits between your thoughts and the body's actions. Consciousness may weigh nothing, but his is dragging you down all the same. Helplessly, you gulp for air and swallow only piss-warm water. You fight harder, but lose even more ground. Put a little bit of a yawn sneak in there. The weak light of the world above is already fading. As you sink deeper into the dismal sea, you can make out the shadow of something below the corpses. Something huge and ancient and awful, all teeth and hunger, which needs no words to convey how small and mean and meaningless you are. Loathing wells up, not from below, but from within. Your flesh and mind resonate with that overpowering will, and your body trembles. A single, massive eye opens, and in a glance assays your entire self. You realize for the first time that you are naked. You see your spindly limbs and sallow, pockmarked skin, your unsexed, withered, worthless body, and you are ashamed. Wait, so he doesn't have a dick? Is that what it's saying? Do all cast-offs not have genitalia? No, that can't be, because we had memories of cast-offs with having sex and stuff, so maybe it's just him. And then everything's gone, and there is nothing but the liminal darkness between dream and reality, life and death, madness and reason. In a fear? At first, there's no reply, but you know he's in here still, thwarted, sullen. In time, he answers.
Who are you? You're not like the others. You're still awake, scheming, grasping. You feel different, like him. How are you here? I've never tasted you.
He pauses briefly in his demands. And you feel his consciousness brush against yours.
Who are you?
For all his frantic questioning, your brother is not yet the madman you met beyond the gate. His mind may be cracked, but it is not shattered. I'm a cast off like you. Came through a mirror caster to help you. Why was Choi Kasul among the dead? Inifir laughs bitterly.
Father taught me to listen with my mouth, fattened beyond grief. I learned to carry the weight of their woes in my flesh and blood.
He pauses.
Saved her the only way I knew.
He pulls away and falls silent. Inifir, are you still there? You sense his seething consciousness lurking somewhere in your mind, but he gives no response. Uh-oh. That's not good. I might have fucked up. Let's wait. Time passes, or doesn't. The darkness does not lighten, the silence does not lift. Inifir is out there. You can sense him, but only vaguely. Besides him and you, there is nothing here at all. Even the dead are, for the moment, speechless. Keep waiting. Nothing changes. You are between moments, and Inifir's patience appears infinite. And I'm spamming three, but keep waiting. I'm spamming one. I'm spamming three. Nothing. It won't do anything, so I have to wake up now. I think I fucked this up. You try to will yourself awake, but inner fear clings to the darkness, its solace and solitude, and forces your flesh back into slumber. So this is how it will be, a test of wills. But for all his resistance, inner fear's consciousness soon retreats into the darkness of your mind, whimpering, giving way. It seems he has little stomach for battle. Can we talk to him again? No? Alright. Keep waiting? No? Alright. Fight, inner fear. Force yourself to wake up. Oh, something's actually happening now. So now we're in like a real memory of his, it looks like the other mirrors. Maybe we kicked his mind out, and now we're gonna do what we've done in the other mirrors, which is actually make the decisions as though we were him. You're on a hard bed beneath a coarse sheet. Voices again surround you, their words the same as the corpse curses. Slut, one chants in an endless mantra. Another mutters shame, shame, punctuated by the slap of rawhide. But these aren't the voices from the dream, only echoes. Your eyes open and you see as never before. Nothing's added or subtracted, but certain details take on new clarity. The mold blossoming from cracked plaster, the blemishes on the weary, rattled face of the woman at your bedside, the sores weeping on another attendant's arms. You're not just in Inifir's body, you're in his misery.
The Master has spoken! The Master has awoken! The woman cries.
She faces the others.
Let us give thanks!
They kneel, and she turns back to you, eyes gleaming with the pleasure of power.
Master, thank you for redeeming us in our suffering, for revealing how, by receiving the world's cruelty, we may escape the world's bondage.
Her humility is cheap and hollow, but the others are deaf to the hypocrisy. They murmur their thanks.
Oh, this is Marcisa. Oh, shit. Marcisa.
Inifir sighs her name, and you're stabbed with his feelings for her. Contempt and craving, alloyed into something harder and sharper than love. So this is the woman who served as Ronos' guide. Something else nags at you, but before you can grasp it, Inifir realizes you're still in his mind and howls, OUT! Inifir, stop interfering with what I'm trying to do here. Alright, we gotta try to do anamnesis here, obviously. Obviously. 100% chance, that's what I'm talking about. Why do I have 100% chance? Because I'm awesome? No. Because I have 3 points in intellect edge, and I'm specialized in the anamnesis skill. So I have huge bonuses. That's how I built my character. Be able to do shit like this. Boom, give me my 100%, son. You plunge deeper into Inifir's mind and remember that day when he first saw the fraud in Marcisa's eyes as she told the children that the wretchedness of their lives had meaning. Not just some meaning, but the only meaning that mattered. She said it, as she always had, but he understood then that, like him, she knew that the only secret of suffering was that it had no secret, no purpose. Like all Inifir's thoughts, this one is rotten. But it has Rot's overpowering sweetness, too. For here was a certainty. However loathsome he might be, she was worse. With that one look, Inifir understood that Marcisa had come to the same end as him. Miserable among the miserable. Not by fate or misfortune or fault of birth, but by choice. She came to grub for the shabbiest of vanities, not even to be first among the least, but to be second. So when the dead voices whipped up waves to drown him in self-hate, Inifir knew he could always cling to the fact of her shameless grasping after shame and keep from sinking into oblivion. The memory slips away and you are back in the bedroom, seeing Marcisa all the more clearly through Inifir's eyes. Yeah, this is good writing. This is good writing. Let's try to focus on the nagging sensation. You try to shut out the room around you, the litanies chanted by the cultists, the sharp sounds of pain being inflicted and received, as the outside world fades, an inner one rises up. The same accusations from the dream resound inside you, not spoken, but understood, a drone of humiliation and loathing and disgust that drowns out other thoughts and feelings. Still, there is something more. Not the dead, not Inifir, not you. Something like a little chime ringing inside your eye.
The ward! Cries Inifir. He's here. My father is here.
The ward? This whole fucking mirror is like an interactive Marilyn Manson song. Inifir leaps from the bed, fully in control of your shared body. The sheer force of his exuberance sends your thoughts reeling. As adrenaline floods his flesh, you turn giddy, but it only seems to sharpen his thoughts.
Now, children, we are to be tested.
His voice is greased with unpracticed insincerity, but the others cry out in joy.
Now comes one who would steal the keys to the gate and twist the rising path of suffering into a downward spiral.
Downward spiral. That's a great Nine Inch Nail album. And this is pretty Nine Inch Nails-ish. Across the room in long, quick strides.
But we are not unready. Let us meet him in the gallery.
Wait, is the changing god gonna show up here? Dude, this is cool. Rough-hewn stairs lead to an enormous room, more cavern than hall, that ends in wooden gates. The chiming of the wards is louder, faster. The chatter of the dead is incessant. But more than anything, you feel the weight of Inifir's will and the bloody purpose to which it is put. All these years he has expected your father's return. His mind repeats over and over,
not helpless, not again, not helpless, not again.
You know what he knows, that under the floor there are Numenera, that hidden in cracks and crevices are ciphers. You see what he sees, the faithful girding themselves for battle. This is not a homecoming, it is an ambush.
Inifir, listen to me. I want to talk to our father.
No, Inifir decrees. I have traced his thoughts from the scars in my mind. I have heard his words from dead lips. He has no more to teach.
Inifir nods to Marcisa, who hands him a barbed spear graven with strange geometric glyphs. He dips it in his flesh and wets its tip with blood. So he just stabbed himself with his own spear. Just so it would have some blood on it. That seems legit. Your blood. His blood.
Let him taste what I have lived.
Inifir whispers, more to himself than to you. Oh, damn. Oh, shit is getting real. This is awesome. Look at that. Look at that picture. It's really awesome.
Suddenly, the gates shatter inward. Before the splintered wood and twisted iron even hit the floor, the children have fallen to their knees, sobbing, clutching their ears, helpless. It is not your father who has come. Floating in the breach, wreathed in smoke, is the sorrow. Oh shit, it's the sorrow. For the moment, it makes no move, though it gives no hint as to why.
It's not him.
Inifir whispers, and though he still stands, he is as paralyzed as his followers. Marcisa acts first, pushing herself to her feet and shrieking commands.
Receive the horror! Embrace it! Stand! Guard the master! Obey the master!
The others rise uncertainly while the sorrow abides. Kind of like the dude. The dude abides. Sorrow abides too. Maybe the sorrow is actually the dude. If you don't know what dude I'm talking about, I'm talking about The Big Lebowski. It's a movie. Inifir remains stupefied. Throwing my spear at the sorrow would be meaningless. Telling them to attack would be meaningless. Telling him to spring the traps, forcing him to spring the traps, or trying to get Inifir to listen to me, or flee. Let's study the sorrow. It is an object that defies scrutiny. You are certain it's the same thing you faced before, but it's different, and not just in subtle ways. Its texture and even anatomy seem altered, and indeed they continue altering before your eyes. But exactly how it is changing, you cannot say, just as you cannot manage to wrap your mind around its contours. The more you look at it, the more your head aches. No, not your head. Something else. Something more fundamental. Whatever it is inside you that calls the tides and answers them, that is where the pain is. At last, you break your gaze, unable to maintain it any longer. The sorrow remains unmoving within the breach in the gateway. It makes no gesture, issues no demands. It is waiting for something, or looking for something, or pondering. There is no way to judge what passes within its mind, if it even has more than mere instinct. You feel the tides washing around you, stirred up by the sorrow's arrival. But here in Inifir's body, in his mind, you have no means to turn them to your advantage.
Inifir, listen to me. This thing, it's called the sorrow. It will kill you all if you don't act.
For a moment, Inifir gives no reply. Then, his voice choked and shrill with terror, he says simply,
"Run. Hide. We must escape."
We. A form of progress in the face of annihilation. Oh, now we're a team. The smoke around the sorrow churns, and its alien gaze sweeps across the room with a predator's contempt for kine, but without a predator's hunger. Its patience, like its resolve, is inexhaustible and almost indifferent. The children cower as its gaze passes over them, and some cry out,
"Master, save us!"
But Inifir is gone, hidden somewhere in the recesses of your mind, as indifferent to their terror as he was to their praise.
Inifir, you need to spring the traps.
Your words, your thoughts, make your way to the dark corner of your mind where Inifir is hidden. You feel him stir, numb and mute. A piece of knowledge unfolds, how to trip the traps rigging the hall. It takes no more than a whisper.
Birth.
The room explodes with light and sound. Prismatic beams blast from machicolations. Synth nets spring from corners. Projectiles pepper the sorrow. Energy fields encase it. After the fireworks comes stillness and silence. The sorrow is unharmed. If anything, it is stronger. Wings unfurl, arms stretch, fields shatter, nets sunder, and myriad darts fall free from its body.
Birthless,
a dead voice whispers.
Vain idiot.
Well, obviously the spear isn't gonna do shit then. The sorrow sweeps forward into the hallway, moving so fast you can hardly track it. It swaddles one of the children in its shifting limbs, and when it releases him, he is simply snuffed out. Not dead, but gone. The sorrow pauses above its kill and seems to read the room again, seeking without finding, but implacable as ever. Fuck it, let's throw the spear. Why not? You fling the spear with all the strength Inifir's muscles can muster, which is not much, not compared to the body you left behind. The weapon is surprisingly light, a masterpiece of the killing arts. It soars towards your foe as if steered and propelled by some internal mechanism. The glyphs glow. It gets within a foot of the sorrow before a wisp of smoke touches it, and the spear disintegrates into a cloud of drit. A moment later, the tiny shards drop to the floor. The sorrow is not merely unharmed, but unfazed. Well, okay, I didn't think that was gonna work. As the sorrow begins to stir again, Marcisa grabs you by the shoulder, her nails drawing blood.
Enough!
She hisses. She pulls you back, and you find yourself following. She's pulled Inifir back too, it seems. As you retreat, Marcisa cries out,
"Stand! Rise upon the pain!"
The slaughter that ensues behind you is strangely silent. Shuffling steps, half-hearted battle cries, smothered deaths. Marcisa hurries you through a warren of tunnels until you pass through another gate, this one made not of wood and iron, but of solid azure steel. As you pass through, the vault seals shut behind you. Oh, this is cool. This is very cool. You never found this one? Root Brittany, how's it going? Never found this one. You find this one by going to the room with the endless gate in it, searching in the little object off to the side. You find a mirror caster. Then when you go and talk to Inifir, you convince him to open the mirror caster for you so that you can go into this mirror. So we're in Inifir's memories. The room has the faded opulence of a lost civilization. The ornate reliefs carved from the granite walls have crumbled and eroded to abstract deformities. Ancient flickering lights line the ceiling. Their humming resonates with the metal floor, and their bluish light illuminates the tarnish. In the center of the room, a silver throne rests on a dais. It kind of looks like the Game of Thrones throne. Unlike the floor, the throne shines as if recently polished. Tiny gleaming needles line the armrests, and a halo-like ring hangs above the back, except for the halo-like ring. Marcisa is doubled over, gasping for breath, retching. Your own body, weak as it may be, is untroubled. Inifir's gone, again, yet something lingers like spores from his mind infecting yours. Let's examine the throne. As you study it, a memory bubbles up and bursts into your consciousness. Inifir sits motionless on the throne. Marcisa adjusts dials on its back. The children gather around like suppliants seeking an audience. "Now," Marcisa intones, "be one with the master." Inifir has only an instant to ponder how he has consented to this abomination before the vastening overtakes him. The children wail, writhe, soil themselves, vomit. One staggers to her feet and drags a dagger across her throat. Another gouges out his eyes. They're hearing the voices, feeling the loathing that has festered inside Inifir. It's more than mortals can bear. It's sublime. Yeah, if I still have it, if it doesn't take it away from me, I'll show you the Mirrorcaster after, yeah. His memory ends. His shame lingers. Marcisa rises to her feet, a bit unsteadily. She examines both you and herself, as if searching for physical evidence of the peril you've escaped. She finds none. The Sorrow's violence fell upon others, who remain at its mercy beyond the vault door.
"Master, tell me how I may serve, what I may endure in your cause."
Hidden though Inifir may be, his contempt at this continued fraud burns in your gut like acid.
Inifir, your mind's bleeding into mine. Can you use that to give me Choi's remains before it's too late?
You know Inifir hears you. You feel him pondering, the weight of his thoughts shifting beside your own. At last, in a low hiss, he answers,
"You're a fool. If you want this burden, take it."
Then his mind stabs into yours like a syringe, and the echo of Choi that survived inside him is now inside you. He withdraws, but she remains, and it is as if a pall has settled over your consciousness. Inifir seems about to speak, but in the end, he says nothing. In the recesses of your mind, you hear a faint weeping. Whatever your grief, this will surely be a better home for her. Oh, I'll bet, Choi is gonna be an echo in our labyrinth, our mind labyrinth, after this. There is a new sound, almost masked by the humming of the ancient lights. It's coming from the vault door. It seems the Sorrow has made its way through the children.
"Coward," hisses a ghastly voice. "Shame."
But they are not the ones calling to Inifir now. It is the temptation of the gate, the promise that he will outlast another day.
"Inifir?"
He doesn't answer your call, but you can hear him whispering to himself, or perhaps to the dead souls who haunt his mind.
"The gate,"
he says, over and over again. Eventually, thoughts rise up from the ferment of his terror, and you understand how he opens the endless gate. It's not a tidal surge, not even some cast-off power. It's simply a matter of turning inward and embracing the horror inside him. He doesn't even open the gate himself. The creatures beyond do. He only needs his suffering to shine like a beacon across the plains, and they worm their way to him. And now you know how to kindle that flame. This is definitely reminding me of Planescape Torment right now. Suddenly, a huge blister forms on the vault door, glowing white. Moments later, another blister rises, and the huge ancient barrier begins to take on the look of a leper's face. That the door is yielding to the Sorrow is perhaps less surprising than that it is holding at all. Indeed, it seems that the barrier has some life in it still. Despite its disfigurement, there are not yet any signs of structural failure. What is this place? Arcisa gives you an odd look, as if you should know the answer, as if it is madness to ask a tourist question while death itself roams the halls, but she replies all the same.
This is the Sanctum Sanctorum, where Sibyl shared their lucid dreams with princes and peasants and popes.
She smiles faintly.
You wanted a place where you could be alone. I gave it to you.
You remember. Inifir remembers the day you came to this retreat, more fortress than temple, hacked from granite hills. Not alone, the children trailing you like chicks, but inside the promise of solitude. A false promise, like all the ones life makes. For the moment, the vault door still holds, though more blisters have risen and burst across its surface. It is only a matter of time before the sorrow gains entry. How does the throne work? Narcissa shrugs.
It's a mystery. When you sat upon it, we shared in the ecstasy of your suffering. When the Sibyl sat upon it, they shared their dreams. Only the Herephi who assembled it for them could say how it works, and he has long since turned to dust. I know only enough to activate and amplify the device.
Now the door has become mottled. Its alloyed ancient elements are separating. A lattice of hairline cracks appears, and you hear a low moaning, as of a beast that has endured too much punishment. The dead voices cackle about vanity and futility and how all that you touch turn to schist, and the others give their own message, the comfort of a familiar whip and the promise you won't perish.
Enough with the charade, Marcisa. I know you don't believe in any of this.
Marcisa frowns.
Master?
She begins, before trailing off. She stares intently, perhaps reading Inifir as easily as he read her. Eventually, she shakes her head.
You're wrong. There is something I've believed in all this time. If I could help you find some good in all your suffering, prove that it gave hope to others, meaning to others, if I could lighten your burden even a gram, then...
She shakes her head again.
We've all suffered, Inifir. There must be something good born from it, even if only a noble lie.
Inifir's jaded senses can find no falsehood in her, and you feel him sink even further into despair as he realizes Marcisa is not the hypocrite he believed. Everything you've done was wasted. That's kind of cold.
We can't escape suffering with lies, Marcisa. Only with understanding.
Marcisa shakes her head.
No, she answers. The more I understand of the world, the more I see to hate.
Her sad, ugly face twists in a sad, ugly smile. I would argue that she's not really understanding. With a true enough understanding, you can escape from hate and fear. That's what I'm saying. Her sad, ugly face twists in a sad, ugly smile.
Sometimes, Master, I'm afraid you've come to understand too much, and now you're alone in the dark truth. But thanks to that, you will shine all the brighter for the children.
But you know what Inifir's light draws, and his consciousness stirs and brings forth memories, vague and awful, of the creatures beyond the gate. It is coming now. There is a stillness in the air, the prickle of a storm about to burst. The tides are being stirred. Marcisa feels it too. She stops her pacing and stares at the vault door, at the widening, hissing cracks. Inifir feels it and twitches free from his stupor. Terror has put its spurs to him, and those beyond the gate offer a lump of salt. The door bursts. The sorrow enters. The gate opens. Flaming, fetid, familiar, beyond is pain and those who delight in pain. As the sorrow ponders this eruption, Inifir runs toward the gate. Closer, closer. You smell the sulfur, but the sorrow has your scent now and moves like the wind, too fast.
No!
Cries Marcisa, diving between you and the sorrow. She slows it for only an instant before it turns her to a red mist. It's enough. Inifir crosses over. She sacrificed her life to save him. Behind you, the sorrow floats impotently. It cannot or will not cross the threshold. It goes. Then the pain comes, a great wave that washes all else away, and you're drowning in it, and at last your mind can bear no more. Oh, that was an intense mirror. Long, too. Must complete new reflection forming in the labyrinth. Never has your body been a more welcome home than when returning from Inifir's mirror. Though his wretchedness lingers in your memory, you see again through your own eyes, and even this horrific place seems more wholesome than the refuge where Inifir faced a sorrow. Inifir stares at you with newfound recognition, but even as he does, you feel a dark presence stirring around you. The same one you sensed in the mirror. Something has sensed your meddling and means to put an end to it. Inifir smiles, for the first time without spite.
Sister, he says softly, not so little, not so young. Now you are truly flesh of my flesh.
Then he shudders as if he has taken a chill, and a shadow passes over his face. That's why you protected Kiatawa. She reminds you of Marcisa. Need to close the date. Kill yourself, brother! Atone for Choi's death! Damn. I'd like to ask you some more questions. Let's go with this. I wanna talk about Kiatawa for a moment.
That's why you protected Kiatawa. She reminds you of Marcisa somehow, doesn't she?
I'm starting to figure this weird place out.
Level up for Rin. Inifir says nothing, but his furtive glances at everything. But you say enough. His furtive glances at everything but you. Say enough.
I'd like to ask you some more questions.
For a moment, Inifir seems ready to invite your inquiry. Wait, what? I still have to fight him? No! No!
Damn it.
I wanted to say the other thing, but I thought maybe I could ask him something first. For a moment, Inifir seems ready to invite your inquiry. Then his smile grows wide and wolfish, his eyes wild. He laughs.
Always grasping, clasping, rasping at my thoughts, trying with wiles to file my mind to a shape that suits your needs. No!
He shakes his head.
No, sister. Now we will see how you care to be carved upon.
And with that, he readies himself for battle. No, I already fought him.
I feel terrible.
By the Black Three.
I might have to fight him no matter what, but... Dude, I hate that myalgic dust shit. Hold on a damn minute. Hold on a damn minute. We're scum saving right now. Or we're save scumming, whatever. And now we get the sound, which is glorious. We already talked to them. Let's just blaze through this really fast. Now that I'm not actually going to be reading it. Oh, I got to go through all the fucking questions, though. Alright, hold on. This is going to take a second. Happened to her. He loved her. I knew more about her. Tell me about Choi. If you mention Choi again, we have to fight. Okay, I won't mention Choi again. Tell me about the endless gate. Teach me anything about the gate? Alright, let's talk about something else. Stop your followers' violence interfere. Close the gate then. Oh yeah, we gotta go through the dreams and everything. Tell me your dream. Is father eating you? Destruction can bring an end to suffering. Good can spring out of past wrongs. Persuasion, 90%. How about we not fuck this up? Great. Alright, now we come to the Mirrorcaster thing.
Updated my journal.
You wanted it found. You want someone to understand you. Persuasion, 75%, we'll make it 95. Then we go into the mirror again. Concentration check, 100%. Move towards Choi. Interfere. 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 Wait. Waiting, keep waiting. Alright, well, then we wake up. Interfere, are you still there? Alright, then we get to this part. We do anamnesis. Focus on the nagging sensation. I want to talk to our father. Study the sorrow. Talk to interfere. Spring the traps. Throw your spear. Them in the throne. Choice remains.
I'm starting to figure this weird place out.
Interfere. What is this place? How does the throne work? Enough with the charade. I'm gonna say something different here, actually, than I said last time. Because I wish I'd said this. You've been a good servant, Marcisa. She cocks her head and eyes you suspiciously, as if you've heard nothing she said. As if you said something she's never heard. In the end, she gives no reply beyond a small nod of neither satisfaction nor agreement. Simply an acknowledgement that there's nothing more to be said. Alright, then this... all the same. And finally we're done with the mirror. So this time I do not want to ask him more questions. I ask him about Kiyotawa. Alright. Now. Number one. Man, just asking more questions here fucks the whole thing up. Inifia, you need to close the gate. Now, before they take control of you. Your brother nods.
This place has brought but woe and false hope. Let it go.
Making a note.
Inifir seals his eyes shut and begins to howl. You feel the world about you shifting and churning. Everything grows dark and empty, save for voices almost as soft as silence itself. I think we actually succeeded without a fight! I mean, I already fought him. I fought him earlier and beat him. But that wasn't really how I wanted to resolve it.
I'm starting to figure this weird place out.
We actually did it.
I need to talk to you.
Somehow, Inifir's decision to close the gate forces you back outside. Inifir is gone. There's no telling where, but the gate has closed behind you. Without the gate, the cultists have no reason to kill anymore. Or less reason, at least. You're not the only thing that's been expelled from the gate. A small pile of objects lies at your feet. Oh, do I still get his loot? Even though we didn't fight him? Villano del Toboso.
Ah, That was well done, he says, clapping you on the shoulder. A knight should always seek a peaceful resolution to problems, to treat bloodshed as a last resort.
He only sounds half convinced by his own words, but claps you on the shoulder again, making your teeth ache.
Well done, noble knight. Very well done.
Then he shuts his eyes. All right. Why are you closing your eyes?
Our adventure together is done, he says gently. It is time to find another. But eyes are poor organs. They can only see things as they are.
He straightens.
Instead, I will walk until I am needed, listening for the cries of the lost and the weeping of the hopeless. Only deprived of sight can I feel the tugging of destiny upon my heart, leading me where I must go.
I like this guy. See, we didn't get to have this other conversation with him either when we killed him. When we killed Inifir. Are you going again?
Where I am needed,
he says with quavering dignity, his eyes still tightly closed. Farewell, Viano del Toboso.
You as well, noble knight.
So now that was a good way to resolve it. We avoided bloodshed. We convinced Inifir. We went through an extremely long conversation with him. We got people ready to level up. Allegern wants to talk. It even says it on his tooltip, wants to talk. I don't know if Root Brittany's still here, but I could try to show... Here's the Mirrorcaster. This is the one, the twisted metal Mirrorcaster that we used to deal with, to get into the mirror with Inifir. I probably can't use it again. Pull the Mirrorcaster from your belongings again. It sings to you in tangled words beyond your understanding, urging you to sample the memories locked within. Access the mirror again. Whatever Inifir did when he unlocked his Mirrorcaster is beyond you. You twist and turn the Mirrorcaster as you think he did, but nothing happens. It was right here. It was right here in this little thing. This is where it was. You had to touch the symbol on this thing, and it opened up and it gave you that Mirrorcaster.
Let's go.
So did I get the same loot? Same exact loot! The enigmatic sphere that we read about that gets heavier the faster it goes. The impossible blade, which looks pretty cool. And the shins. Alright, so let's take a look at our quest journal real quick. Endless horror. Inform the memorialist the gate is closed. It wasn't easy, but I convinced Inifir to close the gate and leave the valley. I doubt he'll open it again anytime soon. I should return to the memorialist to tell them what I've done. And then this one, Severed Child. Choi's spirit, I suppose, was in the chaos of Inifir's mind. I managed to pull her out of his mind and into mine while I was in Inifir's mirror. Maybe it will help her and Inifir to find peace. So now, if I go in back into my labyrinth, I'll bet I'll find her in there. Let's see. What's she gonna spend XP on? She can't do edge, she can just do stat pools or effort. Okay. Well, she's got a fuck ton of speed pool at this point. Let's get some more intellect. Maybe one intellect, one speed. What can Rin do now? She can increase her edge, but does she even ever use? I mean, she never really even uses any of her... We could give her speed edge to help with hiding. We'd give her a lore, but not really gonna help that much. Let's give her speed edge to help with hiding. Yeah. It'd also help if she shoots somebody with the buzzer, but that's pretty pointless. Alright, so then we've got this thing, which is just an oddity that we're going to sell, so give that to him. And the mirror caster, that thing's useless now, so give that to him. And who's going to use the impossible blade? And I'm not going to use it because it's not an intellect weapon. Matt Kina is good at light weapons, so she's not going to use it. Rin's obviously not going to use it. Now, he might use it, though, because it's a medium weapon. He's good at medium weapons, but it uses speed instead of might, and now he's all put everything into might here, so I don't think he's going to use it, actually. I don't think anybody's going to use it. I think we're just going to sell it, as cool as it is, and it is a cool weapon. I think we're just going to sell it for a whole bunch of shins. Alright. Let's see what Allegern wants.
Innifer. Another cast off, another stain. Look, I've got to ask. Why do you think so many of your kind cause so much pain?
Good question.
Because we're born into danger, because the sorrow hunts us all from the moment of our birth, because so many people hate us for the accident of our birth and the crimes of our creator. I don't know, Allegern. Why don't you tell me?
He holds up his hands.
Hold on, I didn't say you.
Oh, and why not? I mean, look at me. I'm the White Death. I've killed armies of men. I've made my share of orphans. I serve the old Memavira of the Bloom. It's not like my hands are clean.
She leans in and whispers,
but it's not like yours are either, are they?
For a moment it appears he is going to strike her. For her part, she seems supremely unconcerned. He breathes out,
point taken!
He turns to you.
What's your take, then?
Good question. Oh my god, thanks for the host. Dennis, Malik 70 hosting me. Is this a Malik 70 raid? How's it going, Wizards All the Way 109? Welcome. Thank you, Dennis. Dennis X, Malik 70 X. Thank you for this. I really appreciate it. Anybody that's here watching, if you're not following Malik 70, you are doing yourself a disservice. He's a great guy, great streamer, plays all kinds of good games, mostly open world type games, generally. And he's a cool dude. You should go check out his channel. Put him on follow. I'm doing all right, Wizards, thanks. Oh, you were playing some Horizon Zero Dawn? Damn, I missed it. I wanted to watch you playing that, but the timing apparently did not work out. Was it fun? Still enjoying that game? Let's see, what are we going to say in answer to this question? I like number two. Number two is exactly what I thought in my actual head brain. My head brain? Yes, my IRL head brain. The thing inside my skull. Why do so many ordinary humans cause so much pain?
But ordinary people also bring good. I'm trying to think of a cast-off known for good deeds and greatness, and I can't.
Well, there's me.
Doesn't mean they don't exist.
You're gonna continue tomorrow night? Cool, I hope I can check that out. Up the map a little. Yeah, no problem, Root Brittany.
Maybe. Doesn't seem like your type is really cut out for a life of anonymity, though. Anyway, let's get moving, eh?
Old Tide raised a tiny amount. Alright, there's nothing else for us to talk to him about at the moment. How are you holding up?
As well as can be expected.
He always says that. What's the point in even giving you that question? They always say the same thing. Let's move on. Real quick, we'll check if we're in our...
Yes?
Takes her a while to notice you as she looks around in awe. Alright, nothing new here. Matt Kina.
What now?
How are you holding up? She shrugs. Do you actually care? She looks at you waiting. Yeah, I care. You watched the entire HZD Let's Play. The plot is amazing. Yeah, it looks so good to me. That game looks so good to me. I'm tempted to get PS4. I mean, not just for that game. There's lots of PS4 games that I want to play, but it does. I would. That's probably the first one I'd play though. But I don't know yet if I'm gonna get one. All right. So cool. We solved this. All the side quests here are done. All we need to do now is go talk to the memorialists and get up out of here. I'm about ready to get another advancement here, which is nice. We can sell a few things.
I'm there, in the shadow.
Just gonna go back to the entrance. Thanks again for the host and the raid, Dennis. I really appreciate it. I wonder if I can talk to them about anything now that I've resolved the issue. Probably not, but you never know. No, same thing. What about Talira? Oh, I can tell her.
What can I do for you, Savior?
I found a tomb below for a girl named Choi Kaisul. Do you know anything about her?
Kaisul? Well, I don't know anything about her, but you might ask my colleague, Ronos Kaisul. He should be in the valley somewhere, if the cultists haven't killed him, that is.
Yeah, Bloodborne looks pretty interesting. I don't know anything about the Persona series. But I want to play The Last of Us. And I don't remember exactly. There were several games that I couldn't get on PC that were on PS4.
I closed the gate. Hopefully the cultists will stop bothering you soon.
Truly.
Her face becomes full of light.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Both the living and the dead are forever in your debt.
I'll remember that.
I regret I have nothing to give you. We do not have much in the way of personal possessions. However, there is one who might. Ronos Kaisul. He likes to collect odd relics from the alcoves outside. He would be more than happy to reward you on our behalf, I'm sure, if he has anything to give. Seek him out in the valley.
Very well. Got some new gear, too. Awesome. Yeah, you're playing a couple of really good games that I'm interested in watching right now. Horizon Zero Dawn and Wildlands. Gotta be hard to decide what to play. What can I do for you, Savior? Very well. Alright, so we had a journal update. Find Ronos Kaisul for a reward. I told Talira and the Necropolis that the gate is now closed. She was very grateful and said I should talk to Ronos in the valley about a reward. Shadow of Mordor. Such an awesome game. Alright, we're out of here. I'm gonna have to end this episode here, but if you're watching the stream, don't go anywhere because I'm not done playing. I'm gonna keep right on streaming, right on playing, but if you're watching on YouTube in the future, this episode is now over. So thank you for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Torment. tides of Numenera.